Professor James Tabor, I must say, there's a lot of controversy surrounding the idea of the ossuary of James, and is this really his bones? And some want to say it's a forgery and that there's scratch marks on it from later or something. I don't really know the inside out, but yeah. I can tell you this. If we found him, the brother of Jesus, and that would like be a big, big deal. So you talk about they may have found the Nazareth ossuary bone box. Can you tell us what this is and your expertise in this and what you've discovered?
Well, it's nothing to do with Nazareth. It's in Jerusalem.
Okay.
But, the so-called James Ossuary, as it's now being called, it belongs to a antiquities collector. His name is Oded Galan. I know him well. And his story is that he bought it from a shop, an antiquities shop in the Silwan area, which is just outside the old city, kind of to the south and to the east, and that he kept it for years, and he could read it. You can read it if you even know modern Hebrew. But he said, I didn't know Jesus had a brother. You know, he's Jewish, and a lot of Jews, particularly, he's not, you know, a religious Jew. He's secular, I think, in that sense, just an Israeli kind of Jew. He said, I didn't know Jesus had a brother, so I didn't go like, oh. And remember, it's Yaakov, not James. So Jacob, Joseph, Jesus, you know, it's like it didn't ring a bell with him. That's what he claims. Now, when it was revealed in right around the turn of the millennium, 2000, 2001, up to 2003, there was a lot of controversy. Herschel Shanks and an epigrapher, Lemaire, Ben Witherington, filmmaker Simka Jakubowicz, they all sort of got behind it. I got invited by Shanks, the editor of Bar Magazine, to view it along with a whole Kyle McCarter. Well, I'm not going to name everybody there, but there were 8 or 10 really major Hebrew Bible scholars that were there. And we were all just amazed, you know. This was at a meeting in Toronto, the Royal Toronto Museum. And so it became controversial because it's non-provenance. Like, where did this collector really get it? And when did he really get it? And is it possible that it was an ossuary that said James, son of Joseph, and somebody added brother of Jesus to make it valuable, and then began to pitch this whole James thing? Eisenman thinks that. He thinks nobody would have thought of James, but after his work, whoever forged it said, oh, this is picking up speed. I'm going to add that. Forging it. And there was a trial. It lasted for many years. Had to do with some other things he was charged with. And he was acquitted. No proof of forgery. It doesn't mean it's authentic, but he was acquitted on all the counts and everything to do with the James ossuary. It's not full of bones. But in every ossuary, we've got one here that might have showed when you were filming. That one's totally cleared out, but I've seen the James ossuary several times, and there's still skeletal material stuck to the sides, unless you just take a spatula and you'd have to really dig down. So it had bone skeletal material that could belong to the person who was buried there, or if there was more than one person in it, because ossuaries sometimes have more than one. But didn't have a skeleton or anything that you could check like that. So anyway, the trial acquitted Oded. I will say this, Oded told me, and he's, other than Musayef, who died a few years ago, Oded is probably the greatest collector of antiquities in Israel, meaning he has the greatest collection. They're all legal. You know, he doesn't buy anything in the black market. He said to me that he's never sold anything. He said, I do this because I love it. Like, in other words, he's not an antiquities dealer. He's an antiquities collector. He loves his stuff. And so he doesn't really fit the bill. I think he's pretty, his family, you know, is well provided for. It's not like, you could say, well, it would be worth millions of dollars. Maybe he forged it. So lots of people think that last part was forged. The trial did it was not conclusive on that. After my, I'm no expert on all this, but I think Herschel Shanks followed it very closely in Bar Magazine, and your listeners and viewers can go back and, you know, look that up. There's a lot on my blog. Ben Witherington's book is still good. He wrote it with Herschel. I think the case favors authenticity. Now, whether that means it's Jesus' brother or not, you have to do stats and you have to make other kinds of leaps. And then there's the question of where it came from. There is new evidence that you can read on my blog. If you just jamestabor.com and you type in James Ossuary, you'll get all the posts on Ossuary. And the latest one, not the latest on my site, but the latest on James, I think it's from last year, is a peer-reviewed scientific article arguing that soil tests done by the Israel Antiquities Authority and the Israel Geologic Society have shown that it most likely came from what we call the Talpiot Jesus family tomb. So that would actually put it in a context of other names, including Jesus, son of Joseph, and so forth, that some have argued could be the family tomb of Jesus's clan, let's say, whether it's Jesus or not, the clan. So that's changed things. It hasn't got picked up on much or talked about. I haven't even seen anybody refute it particularly, but that's out there if people want to read it. And it's the full scientific report. I mean, it's huge because it has all these tests about, and what they do with the soil is they check trace elements, like how much iron, how much copper, how much aluminum, how much this. And every tomb has its own environment. It's like a fingerprint. Even a tomb 30 feet away have a different environment because of atmosphere, the way water seeps in, erosion, everything. And so the person who headed the research, R.A. Shimron, he's completely convinced. He said, I can tell you one thing, whatever it is, the ossuary came from the Talpiot tomb. Doesn't mean they didn't add Brother of Jesus. Maybe that was added. So I think at this point, it's all we can say about that ossuary. I would lean heavily toward it being authentic. And I think they're just probably more, you know, most of us in the business, if it's not provenanced, it's just like, leave it alone. That's kind of the feeling. So people really don't want to talk about it anymore in the academy. They're like, come on, don't bring that up again. But there are new possibilities that can be done in the future. I'm involved in some of them. It mainly has to do with DNA profiles of all the ossuaries that have any significant bone remains and doing then what we would call a DNA prosopography, where we begin to do relationships among people in all the tombs. And now with the more sophisticated DNA tests, you can take scrapings from any ossuary and get DNA material. That's been shown now. There is a tomb in Jerusalem, the first time this was ever done. Shimon Gibson and I found it in the year 2000. It's called the Tomb of the Shroud, because we found the only first century burial shroud dated by carbon 14 to the first century. And we did DNA on all the skeletal remains. We're able to come up with, it's not a family tree in the sense of like, this is the, but like, these two women are sisters or maternally related, and they're also related to this woman who appears to be older. This person here is not related at all. And they, so it's just a little beginning. That's been published as well in PLOS, P-L-O-S, which is a very respected scientific journal. So I think in the future, we could take tomb after tomb. There are tombs on the Mount of Olives that have very interesting names, like Shimon Bar Yonah. That would be interesting. Simon Bar Jonah, is it like another Simon Bar Jonah, or is it Simon Bar Jonah? There's tombs that have the name Lazarus, Mary, Miriam. There's one tomb on the Mount of Olives has Mary and Martha in the same ossuary, two women. So some of those are privately owned, some are owned, you know, they belong to the State of Israel. So I think there's hope that the DNA might begin to show at least who's family related. But right now, because of COVID, that whole project has stopped. So now for 2 years, nothing's been done. But it could pick up again. And that wouldn't be the, it wouldn't be in the interest of like proving to James Ossuary anything of that sort. It would be, now that we have the Ossuaries and the names, we got 600 and something names, 3,000 ossuaries, all of them don't have names. And we have what tombs many of them come from, but others we don't have what tomb they're from. So you could begin to take one where we don't have what tomb, and not just with soil, but with DNA tests. Well, actually, this guy has the mitochondrial DNA of this woman over here on the Mount of Olives named Miriam or whatever, you know, and then, you know, maybe that ossuary came to there, and then you could also do soil tests. So I know it's a lot. I probably am not going to live long enough to do much with it, but I am involved in the project. We're not talking a lot about it now because we've actually only done two tombs, the Shroud Tomb and the Talpiot Jesus Tomb, but we haven't completely done the Talpiot Tomb because that was done with DNA over 10 or 12 years ago. And now the DNA, it's unbelievable what you can do. You've probably heard of the advances.
Yeah.
Like you could literally, hey, this will give you my whole genome right there. I've been holding this glass. It's just like unbelievable. You know, my whole genome of James Tabor is in just the oil of my finger touching this glass. Now, ancient is more deteriorated, but their methods of replicating and making many, many copies until finally you're able to tell more. So there's several places in Europe, particularly in Germany, that are using this new unbelievable equipment. It's gonna go everywhere eventually, widespread. So think of all the uses for, you know, health, criminology.
Thank you.
Yep.